night or day. The sixth hour it was, when darkness
to today's Bible reading and devotional time. This is Friday. Yeah. Almost sounds like I forgot it was Friday. How do you do that? Yeah. Anyway, it's day 71 of our 90 days reading through the Gospel and Letters of John. And if you haven't already done so, hit that subscribe bar and then the notification bell when it comes up so you can be notified whenever content is added to the channel, and comment on these videos, like these videos, share these videos. Yeah, you know all that. But today, and I'm using this 90 days reading plan. It was generated by Logos, one of those personalized plans. And for today's reading, it only had John chapter 18, verses 39 and 40, just two verses, which we read and looked at yesterday. So for today, I thought I would take an in-depth look at Barabbas. And that clip we saw at the beginning was from the 1961 film starring Anthony Quinn in the title role of Barabbas. And I saw this film probably about 25 or so years ago. As I remember, it moves kind of slow. It's not a very fast-paced action film or anything like that. And it's a fictional account, of course. We don't know what happened to Barabbas, but that's what might have happened. And in the crucifixion scene, there was a real eclipse that was happening. And director Richard Fleischer scheduled the shooting time around that eclipse. The eclipse happened on February 15th of 61. And he wanted that kind of ethereal or ghostly nature of the whole thing captured. So he set the shooting schedule to coincide with the eclipse that happened that day. The movie was based on a novel by this man, and I have no idea how to pronounce his name. He was a Swedish author, got the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1951, and he wrote this novel, and it was released, I believe, in 1950 is when this novel came out, and it was turned into the movie. And then there have been at least two more movies made since then about Barabbas. And we really don't know anything more about Barabbas than what we see there in the film or in the scriptures. This is from one of the movies. I think this is from the Bible that Roma Downey did. It might be from The Passion of the Christ. I'm not sure, but it's one of the scenes. And you can see Barabbas does not look like the kind of guy you'd want your daughter to bring home to meet the folks. Here's another artist depiction, and you can see, like, this guy here's arms raised triumphantly, and look at all the people around him that are really rooting for this guy to be released. And I don't think you see Jesus in this one, or any depiction of Jesus in this piece of artwork here. So when we look at our text, we see in our text, John chapter 18, verse 39, "But you have a custom that I should release someone to you at the Passover. Do you therefore want me to release to you the King of the Jews? Then they all cried again, saying, not this man, but Barabbas." Now, Barabbas was a robber, is what John says, and we'll take a look at the characterizations of him here in just a second. Now, Peter and John make a reference to Barabbas when they're preaching on Solomon's porch in Acts chapter 3. There where they said, "The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But you denied the Holy One and the just and asked for a murderer to be granted to you." And so this is obviously, he doesn't mention the name, but that's who he's referring to, is Barabbas, and how they demanded that he be released to the people rather than Jesus. And here's another indictment that Peter's bringing against them, similar to the one in Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, when the people asked finally, "What must men and brethren, what shall we do?" And he told them to repent and be baptized. But this is a very similar talk that Peter gives here, or John. They're both there. So, and then Barabbas's rap sheet. Matthew calls him a notable or notorious prisoner. Mark says Barabbas was bound with them that made insurrection and men who in the insurrection had committed murder. Luke says that Barabbas was cast into prison for a certain insurrection made in the city and for murder. And then John just says he's a robber or a brigand or a brigand. I'm not sure how to pronounce it, but basically that is a member of a gang. This is a particularly a gang that ambushed and robbed people in forests and mountains. So you can see, again, he's not the kind of guy you'd want your daughter bringing home, or even your son bringing home. "Hey, this is who I'm going to go hang out with this weekend." "Oh, really, son? Go have a good time." Nah, don't think so. Now, part of the reason I wanted to do this was I've been doing some of my own research for a book that'll probably be my magnum opus. It's going to be a while before I get it done. But you've heard me mention this man, John Shelby Spong, who was the Episcopal Bishop of Newark, New Jersey for about 20 years, about 1979, I think, to about 2009, or it might have gone into the 2000s. Very, very, very liberal. He died in 2021. He was 90, and he died from complications from a stroke that he had. And I really hope the man repented before he died. He, you know, held himself out to be a Christian, didn't believe any of the Bible, or very little of it, I should say. I believe he was a closet atheist. That's my opinion of him. And people who call themselves progressive Christians, I think at their core, are really atheists. Or maybe agnostics, but most likely atheists. So anyway, in his book, Biblical Literalism, A Gentile Heresy, and this is his take on Matthew's account of the gospel, is basically what the book is. He wrote another one called The Fourth Gospel, Tales of a Jewish Mystic, and his conclusions are all pretty much the same in all of them. But here's what he had to say about Barabbas. Examine the name Barabbas, a name that every Jew reading the story for the first time would surely have noted immediately. Bar is one of the Hebrew words for son. In Mark, for example, blind Bartimaeus is identified as the son of Timaeus, which is exactly what Bar Timaeus means. Mark chapter 10 and verse 46. Then he lists some other uses of the word Bar, and then comes back to Barabbas and says that the last half of the name Barabbas is Abba, which is a Hebrew name for father or God. In Mark, Jesus, in a passion story, notice he's in a passion story, prays, "Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me." And again, he quotes some other uses of the word Abba. Now, I don't know what version of the Bible Spong was using. I inserted the New King, or the Old King James text. Here it was the closest I could find when I transcribed this. It was the closest I could find to what he had worded. And then he says this: "So the name of this man we call Barabbas means literally son of God." Now, one of the things I've noticed about what they call themselves progressive Christians, or really regressive non-Christians, is a lot of what they say sounds logical and okay, yeah, that makes sense and all, but I have noticed that there are a lot of times where they'll tell the truth, but not the whole truth, or they'll get close to it and just enough. I think they are deliberately trying to shipwreck the faith of real Christians. And so let's have a look at his claim here that Barabbas means literally the Son of God. Because then he goes on to say, if we were to hear this name as the original Jewish audience of the Gospels heard it, we would recognize that in the drama of the crucifixion, there were two sons of God present in the narrative, Jesus and Barabbas. One of them, Jesus, was sacrificed, and the other, Barabbas, was set free. In the liturgy of Yom Kippur, there were two symbolic animals, one of which was sacrificed, and the other, on which all the sins of the people have been cast, was set free. Are the gospel writers and their story of Barabbas deliberately setting the story of the Passion against the background of Yom Kippur? I would not dismiss that possibility. So we have ample evidence that the liturgy of Yom Kippur was influential in the interpretation of the story of Jesus and his cross, which is just one more testimony to the fact that the liturgy of the synagogue shaped the memory of Jesus. He thinks Matthew is basically following the annual's liturgical calendar of the synagogue. He makes an interesting theory out of all that. I don't think there's really anything to back it up. You could maybe, if you read the book, you'll see you could maybe arrive at that conclusion that Matthew was setting the order of everything to follow that calendar, but yeah, so what? It doesn't really change the truth of the gospel, but you got to remember, they don't believe the Bible when it comes to the regressive Christians. Now, let's look at the name. Barabbas means son of the father, a contrast to the true son of the father, and that's from Fawcett's Bible Dictionary. And then Michael Wilkins, and who edited with David Noel Freeman, the anchor Yale Bible Dictionary, said that Barabbas is evidently the Greek rendering of an Aram name. Now, Aram is kind of a region. I think it's roughly modern Syria, western Syria today. And that's, you can see Aramaic is tied into it, too, the language. But he says, although the precise origin is debated, most scholars suggest that it is a patronymic derived from Bar Abba, meaning son of Abba. Of course, patronymic means it's from the father's side of the family. So some suggest that Barabbas' father was named Abba, although no written evidence exists for the use of Abba as a personal name in Jesus' day. A contemporary of Johann ben Zakkaya, about AD 75, was so named. And thereafter, the evidence for the use of Abba as a personal name is quite conclusive. So that's in the last third of the last quarter. I was never that good at math. The last 25% of the first century is when it became a personal name. Others suggest that Barabbas was the son of a well-known rabbi because Abba was used for esteemed scholars and rabbis. And there are even some codices with a double R in the name, suggesting the possibility that Barabbas is derived from Bar Rabba, meaning son of a teacher. A less likely suggestion is that Barabbas finds its origins as a distinguished abbreviation for the venerated name of Abraham, or the son of Abraham. And then this from Hastings' Dictionary of the Bible, Barabbas, like Bartholomew or Bartimaeus, is a patronymic, possibly meaning the son of the father or the rabbi, according to an ancient reading. And this is where it gets interesting. According to an ancient reading of Matthew 27, verse 17, the brigands, and that's, you know, gang member referring to Barabbas, his name was Jesus. If so, there is a dramatic skillfulness in Pilate's presentation of the alternative to the multitude, which is which of the two do you wish me to release to you? Jesus, the Bar Abba, or Jesus that is called Messiah, or Jesus who is called Christ, is the way most would translate that. And here's Matthew 27 and verse 17. Therefore, when they had gathered together, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release, Barabbas or Jesus who is called Christ?" So if that is true, that Barabbas' first name was Jesus, that would be kind of an interesting play there on words or on titles or names that Pilate would be using, probably to taunt the crowd more than anything else. But what of the word Abba? Spong says that it can mean God. Well, it is a term used to address God, according to Erdman's Dictionary of the Bible. And all three of the New Testament occurrences are followed by the nominative translation, the Father. Mark claims that Jesus addressed God as Abba Father in Gethsemane, but both Matthew and Luke omit the word Abba. Paul asserted that the Spirit cries Abba Father in the hearts of believers in Galatians 4 verse 6, and that believers cry Abba Father in the spirit of adoption, Romans 8 verse 15. Now, there was a trend in the 90s to use, I heard people, they're praying to God, they would say, hey, Dad, we're coming to you to do this or that, and calling him, you know, our heavenly dad, our daddy. To me, that is out of line. That is like going up to someone like the president or the governor, just immediately calling them by their first name when you've never met them, you don't know them, or anything like that. And the justification for it was this word Abba, that a child might have used that to address their father as, you know, Papa or Daddy, and use Abba in that context. Now, in the context of a father, son, yeah, that's fine. My daughter usually calls me Dad, but sometimes she's called me Papa or Pops, or okay, fine. But when you're addressing someone who is clearly of a higher rank than you, you don't use first names, you don't use terms of endearment, maybe in private, after you've gotten to know them, but not right off the bat. So anyway, Erdmans continues that although the formula Abba the Father treats Abba as an emphatic state form, Abba functions as a vocative in the New Testament. Some translations therefore punctuate this formula as Abba exclamation point Father. And since both young children and grown children address their fathers as Abba, this word must be translated as Father and not as Daddy. Abba cannot be defined as a mere babbling sound voiced by little children. Most scholars assume that Abba is Aramaic, though Hebrew cannot be excluded. Abba in the New Testament, the idea of God's intimate relationship to humanity, is a distinct feature of Jesus' teaching. God relates to believers as a father relates to his child. Some would translate Abba as Daddy to convey the close personal meaning of the word, even when Father in the New Testament translates the more formal Greek word Pater. The idea of Abba is certainly in the background. And in Luke 11, when the disciples came and said, teach us how to pray, and he starts off, our Father who art in heaven, the word Father in English is that Greek word Pater. In fact, here it's mentioned when Jesus addressed God as Abba in prayer in Mark 14:36 and taught his disciples to pray in the same terms in Luke chapter 11, verses 1 and 2. Jesus' claims of intimate relationship with God offended many of his opponents because they considered Abba to be overly familiar in addressing God. And in English, if we address God as Dad, I think that is overly familiar. But Jesus' usage established the pattern for the church's view of God and each believer's relationship with him. And then Paul used Abba to describe God's adoption of believers as his children in Romans 8 verse 15, and the change in the believer status with God that results in Galatians 4 verses 6 and 7. So Barabbas's name does not mean son of God. Maybe his first name was Jesus. Okay, we don't know that. But he disappears from history, and so we don't know anything about what happened to him for the rest of his life. So Spong is stretching it to say that his name means literally son of God. It really doesn't. But here's the thing, and this is what we have to understand, and many, in fact, all the progressive Christians that I've read, deny the atonement. They don't believe Jesus died for our sins. They think he died because he got crossways with the Roman Empire and, you know, that sort of foolishness. But God demonstrated his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's Romans chapter 5, verse 8. Most of them will accept this as being authentically Paul's epistle. Paul also said the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now notice the difference in wages and gifts. So wage is something you earn. So if you're not a Christian and you are earning death, separation eternally from God. So then we look at Romans 6. We back up. That was Romans 6:23. Back up to chapter 3, Romans 6, verse 3. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Now, he came out of the tomb, literally will come up one day. We will be raised up. And then in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, if you notice, Paul says in starting in verse 3, I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. So you notice from this that Jesus died, was buried, rose from the dead. Pretty straightforward. And here's Romans 6 that we looked at just a few minutes ago. About two slides ago. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father. Even so, we also should walk in newness of life. Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father. Even so, we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more, death no longer has dominion over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all, but the life that he lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, that's more than what we had in the previous slide, but this is more the full context of it. So if you notice in Romans, particularly the first three verses of chapter 6, at baptism, a Christian is buried, dies to sin and self, and they're raised to walk a new life. Now, here's two illustrations to show what I'm talking about. You notice here, this is a depiction of Jesus here on the cross, obviously. Where did my cursor go? Here he is on the cross. He died and was put into a tomb. And then 3 days later, here he comes out. And so we look at, so then we go and we look at Romans 6, put it right next to it. And here Jesus on the cross, kind of in the background there. And here is somebody in the water about ready to be baptized, goes under the water. They're dying to their old way of life, dying to sin, and then are raised to walk in this new life over here on this side of their burial. Paul describes baptism as a burial. Baptism is an immersion. A lot of people, myself included, got some water sprinkled on them or poured on them, maybe when you were a baby. But that's not a baptism. You were not baptized. You just had some water poured on you is all you did. This is what baptism is. And Acts chapter 2 says it adds you to the church. You can't join the church of the New Testament. You are added to it. After you have obeyed the gospel by being baptized into Christ, this is the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And so if you're in a church that's telling you, well, Jesus didn't die for our sins, okay, get out, just pick up your things and head for the door because you're being led astray. If you're in a church that tells everybody, come on down to the altar and pray the sinner's prayer, you need to get out of there because the sinner's prayer is nowhere in the Bible. If you're in a church that sprinkled you as a baby or just says, well, you get saved today, we'll baptize you in 6 months or 6 weeks after you take our course on baptism, then you still need to get away from them. That is not sound biblical teaching. This is what was taught here in the New Testament in the days of the apostles, back when the church was established. So that is going to wrap it up. So that is going to wrap it up for today. So we'll close out in prayer as we usually do, and praying now for world peace, for countries that are close to the gospel, for the truth of the gospel to get into them. So let's pray. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us through another week. Thank you for all the things that you do. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the forgiveness of sins we have through his atoning work. And I pray for anybody watching this video, Lord, who's seeking the truth, that we can help them find it, that we can help them find sound Christians in the area where they live, so they can be further taught the way of righteousness and be taught more perfectly the scriptures. Pray for those countries where the gospel is censored, many Muslim countries and communist countries. Pray for them, Lord, to open up for the truth of the gospel to be proclaimed there and proclaimed wherever your people are. Thank you for Jesus. Forgive us, Lord. We ask for our sins in Jesus' name. Amen. And if you got any questions, you can leave them in the comment section below, or you can send them to me, to timothy4.2.3@gmail.com. Prayer requests are welcome. I'll be glad to pray with you if you got something going on that you'd like prayers for. And if you are looking for a place to assemble this weekend, for instance, I can try to help you find a congregation in your area. I can't guarantee it, but I can certainly try to find you some Christians somewhere where you can meet with them. That's going to wrap it up for today. That is that's going to wrap it up for today. Thanks for being here. Don't forget to hit that subscribe bar and then the notification bell. And we will see you in the next video. I'm done. I am out. And yeah, you know what time it is. Yeah.